All right, hello there, THP 494 and 598. So today, one of the things I want to do, I'm realizing that one of the important things that we can kind of like put in our heads here as we're working a little bit is to do a little additional tooling up in terms of learning some more techniques about rendering and creating visuals in real time. We're going to start to look more and more on how we use and manipulate data to do that kind of process. But I want us to kind of have a few concepts in our head, especially when it comes to instancing, which is an incredibly powerful technique that we can take advantage of as much as possible, right? Okay, so the thing that we're going to make today is going to end up looking like this. I've got an example file here for us to view. We're after making something that has got this kind of feeling. And even though this might look a little bit complicated, this is actually going to be, should be fun and exciting to build. It's rendered in real time, it's performing at 60 frames a second, and it's going to be hot, hot, hot. All right, so let's take a look at how we might get started in building something like this. So the first thing I want to do is what I typically do. I'm going to move out of my network up here. I'm going to trash this starting project, and I'm going to go ahead and create a new container here. So pardon me, my little search field doesn't show up quite right right now. I'm using a experimental build, and that is an unfortunate artifact in this particular experimental release. So I'll try to make sure that I pause for a moment on these operators that I select to make it as apparent as possible what I'm actually up to. Okay, so let's dive here inside of container one. And in fact, let's give this a sassy name first, like box renderer. Cool. Okay, so let's get started with our kind of simple render network that we're going to kind of always start with, right? So whenever we're rendering anything in real time, we need a few kind of primary ingredients. We need a camera. We need a point to draw that particular network from. We need a piece of geometry to actually draw. And we need a light source. And in this particular case, we don't need a light source, but we're going to throw it in here just to get started, and we'll delete it here in a little bit. Next, we're going to go ahead and head over to the tops category. We're going to add a render, because this is actually how we're going to convert these other components into pixels. And voila, we have a render here. I'm going to go ahead and add a null. Oops, not a normal, a null. Yoink. Here at the end of my network. And I'm going to call my null maybe final. So one of the great questions that one of you asked the other day was, why do I pick the names that I pick for either operators or for different channels? In the case of final, I like final as a kind of ending node on a null because it lets me know that it's the last thing in a string of operators. You're welcome to choose any kind of naming convention that you want. I like to give something that's at the end of a string a kind of a more descriptive name just because that helps me track down where that thing is. I'm also going to back out here and I'm going to go ahead and set the background panel to this. So in the panel page, I'm going to set the background to ./ look inside for final. We can see here that the proportions are not correct, right? And that's because it's actually stretching to fill the area. And if we look in here, we can see our final has got an aspect ratio of 16 by 9. We come out here, we can take a look, and we can see this has an aspect ratio of 4 by 3. So I am just going to go ahead and hard code this right now, 1280 by 720, excuse me, to give this a nice 16 by 9 aspect ratio. And head back inside. Now we'll also notice that here inside we can see that this final is actually being composited over transparent, right? We've got a lot of alpha going on here. That's what this checkerboard means. When we look at our container, that's actually being composited right over black. And that's kind of the nature of our control panel here. So our control panel has a background color. And we can turn that all the way up and all the way down, but it's going to actually display as nothing as such. If we change the background color to say like blue, for example, we should be able to see the blue show up behind it, right? So we have an operator or a viewer, I should say, a top, right? A texture operator that shows up in the background. And because it's alpha, right? Because there is alpha here, that's the reason that we can see the background color here. When there's nothing, then it's just black. We can talk more in class about kind of digging that apart and really understanding that, but that in a nutshell is one of the important things to kind of understand here about what's going on with our container. Okay, let's do some sassy instancing. So we're going to take a look at our geo here, and let's go ahead and dive inside, and let's delete that torus. We're going to add a box. We're going to leave the box with the dimensions of 111. I'm going to go ahead and attach this to a null, just in case for any reason if I decide to change it. I'm going to render it and display it, and I'm going to back out here. And there we have our handy dandy box. Now we can see right now it just looks like a rectangle, and that's partially because the angle that we're viewing it from. So if we were to, for example, split our view here, take a look at our geometry viewer, we could see that it is in fact a box. Right, so let's close this for now. The next thing that we want to do is we're going to do some instancing. So we've talked about instancing before, and instancing allows us to draw one piece of geometry, in this case, this one surface operator, multiple times. And we get to do that almost for free because we do it all on the GPU. And we skip a lot of additional CPU work in that process. So let's go ahead and we're going to grab a grid here. We're going to grab another box. And we're going to use this box as a kind of template for what we're going to actually create here. I have done this already, so I know that I want this to be 4x4x4 are the dimensions that I would like it to have. And let's start there, right? We're going to kind of work procedurally so we can see part of what's going to go on. I'm going to turn this on to display in the background so we can kind of see it show up here as we work a little bit. I'm going to add a null to the end here of the surface operator. And again, I add the null because it kind of saves me a step from re-exporting if I make any changes upstream. That's the reason that I use a kind of placeholder here. Next, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to attach this to a SOP2. I'm going to convert this all into a table. Right, so now I've got a list of all of the coordinates, x, y, z, as well as the normal coordinates for this. Perfect. While I'm at it, I'm going to go ahead and attach this to a null also. And I'm going to call this null instance. Because I'd like to have a descriptive name again. At the end of the chain that's actually going to drive my instancing, I want to give it a name that I can that I know what it is. Next, I'm going to head over to my GL, and in the instance page, I'm going to go ahead and turn instancing on. I'm going to specify that instance is the operator that I'm after. And now I need to define which columns correspond to the translation x, y, z, and rotation values that I want to use. I could use this little drop-down menu, right? Or I can just type in the name. So P0, P1, and P2. Okay. Here we can't really see a whole lot. This is partially because of the position of our camera. So let's grab our camera and let's back out just a little bit more. This gives us a kind of a perspective from a little further away. Okay, so at this point we can see that we're drawing additional instances of this geometry at the coordinates that are specified here, right? And in fact, we might need to back out a little bit more. Let's, while we're at it, let's turn on our divisions. There we go. And we should see now that we've got this kind of like grid-like system going on, right? If we were to come over here to our geometry and make it viewer active, we could see that we've actually got this kind of cube of cubes. That is what we have going on here, which is pretty sassy so far, right? We should also be able to see that we have a total of 63 of those, or 64 of those, here stacked together. All right, excellent. We can see all the coordinates for all of those. I'm going to turn that off right now because I don't really particularly care about it. And while I'm at it, I'm going to go ahead and change the position of our... I am. I'm going to change the position of our camera right now because I want us to actually be able to see this a little bit better. So we could do a number of different things to kind of like dial our camera in. One way to solve this problem would be to use the translate and rotate values for our camera. Now this is kind of a frustrating process, right? Because we've got to do this, rotate, point. Oh, this is a bit dreadful to try and kind of like dial it in to exactly the place where I want it to be. And I would rather not do that if I can help it, right? I'd like a simpler way to think about how I could might drive my camera. And to that extent, what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to go ahead and add a null. So a null allows me to give my camera a point in space that I can look at. Right, so let's take a look at what that might actually mean. So I'm going to open up my geometry viewer. I'm going to move this around a little bit. I often like to, for cameras and nulls, I like to change their scale slightly. I give them a uniform scale of something like 5 because it makes them easier to actually see. In fact, we could do that with our light here also. It just makes it easier to see those objects here. Okay, let's take a look at what's happening with our camera, right? So we can see here as I translate it, it's moving left and right. But in moving left and right, its angle, right, the direction that it's looking isn't changing. Similarly, if I move it up and down, I'm just kind of moving its position here. But I'm not changing at all the direction that it's pointing in. I can use this rotate parameter to change that. That's handy. And if I know exactly where I want to position something, I can use this these values to kind of dial it in exactly the way I want it. I frequently like to have my camera look at something. In the case of our camera, and in fact, in the case of many of our components, we can specify a look at parameter. So I'm going to go ahead and take my null here. I am going to move it a little bit closer to the camera so we can see it a little bit better. Right, there's my null, just those plain crosshairs. And I'm going to tell my camera that I would like it to look at my null. Okay, so by looking at my null, what this means is that wherever I move my null, my camera is going to do its very darndest to stay looking at that particular object. And that's going to be really helpful for us here. So let's take a look at what that means. So I'm going to position my null here, right at the origin, 0, 0, 0. Now, and with that in mind, right, the origin of my null is actually the same as where my geo is located. Right, these are both centered at the zero space for us. So now if I take my camera and I move it left or right, I can see that I'm still pointed towards that center point. I can also do fancy things with my null, right? So for example, I might drive my null past this. I could use my null to pan left or right in an interesting way, depending on what I'm up to. So my null gives me a lot of options in terms of creating a kind of look at scenario. And if we see here down in our render, we can go ahead and close this for now. We can use this to our advantage as we just try and decide where it is that we'd like our camera to be pointing. So I'm going to go ahead and leave my null at 0, 0, 0. I'm going to take my camera. I'm going to position it over here on the right-hand side and translate us up slightly. I'm going to move us just a little bit closer. Right? Yeah. And let's maybe come back a little bit here and down a little bit more. We're going to probably ultimately change this, but for right now, I kind of like this top-down perspective. That's kind of a sassy way to look at this thing. Okay. The next thing I'd like to do here is I would like to animate this guy a little bit, right? I want this to have a kind of the feeling of a little bit of movement here inside of this piece of geometry. I want it to flow a little bit. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to take advantage of the ability to use a transform SOP. We're going to use this transform to do just a little bit of uniform scaling, right? So if we take a look over here, we can see that if we do a little of our uniform scaling here, we've got this kind of interesting way that we can explode this, pow, and then shrink it back down. And I'm going to want to probably scale here from about 0.8, yeah, 0.8, up to maybe 1.2-ish. Yeah, that's the kind of range that I'm wanting to like dig into. That's the feeling I want to have. So we're going to use a chop network. We're going to use an LFO to really make this animation happen for us. Let's go ahead and attach that to a math. And the math will attach to a null. I'm going to go ahead and set my LFO to be Gaussian because I would like it to go 0 to 1. In the range we identified already, I really want like 0.8 to 1.2 to be the range here that I have. And then I can go ahead and grab this and make an assertion here to our uniform scale with a relative chop reference. I can see that might be going a little bit fast. Let's take a look at it over here. That's a little bit faster than I'd like. So I'm actually going to go ahead and turn this frequency down to not 0.1. Let's take a look at what that feels like. Yeah, that's got a nice kind of like flow to it. Ooh, nice. Okay, let's come over here and think about what's going on here just for 1 second. So one of the things that I might do at this point, right, is I might actually reconsider the name for this channel. So I happen to know that Chan1 and LFO1 and NULL3 is actually what's driving this. But depending on how complex I'm building something, and depending on how modular my network has turned out to be, I might rethink the name for this, right? And specifically, I might think about calling this something like U-scale for uniform scale. Now we can see that in doing that, I have actually broken my reference, right? And this shouldn't surprise us because down here, our reference is looking for Chan1. There's no such thing as Chan1, right? There's now U-scale. I tend to, right, this goes back to that question of why do I make the choices that I make when I'm actually naming things. If I know the destination of something and I'm thinking ahead about how I'm going to actually build a kind of relationship inside of my network, I sometimes think about using those descriptive names first. Now, this could be especially important, for example, if, let's say, right, if we were up here and let's have an LFO. Let's say I've got one LFO that's driving one thing, and I decide that I want another LFO with a slightly different frequency to be driving another parameter. And I would like to be tidy, so I'm going to go ahead and pop those into a merge, right? Because that means that I can reference these from a single location. What's happened is now my two FLO, my two LFOs, LFO2 and LFO2 and 3, respectively, which both have Chan1 as their primary channel, when I put them into the merge, they got their names were changed, right? So that one of the parameters here inside of my merge is that I can give them unique names because I can't have a merge one that has two Chan1s. That's a broken namespace. Because I know, right, this is where like the experience of having made plenty of mistakes is coming into play here. Because I know that's going to happen, and because I know that at some point I might actually want to combine some things, I might decide to give these different names, right? So here in the channel, I might give it a descriptive name like X scale, and I might give this one a descriptive name like Y scale. And I might do this way upstream so that I can avoid conflicts as I roll downstream, right? Because this will only continue to happen as I add additional pieces to my network, right? So now I've got Y scale 1 and Y scale. And we can quickly run into a bunch of different kinds of challenges if we're not thinking about our namespace. Now, depending on how, you know, precise you want to be in your programming, that's up to you. This is also, I think, a nice way to make this a little more human readable. So for in this case, I'm going to do op null 3. And we'll go ahead and let it know that uscale is the parameter that I'm after, or the channel, excuse me, that I'm after here. Excellent. We can see that driving everything here for us. Bada bing, bada boom. All right, I like it. I like it a lot so far. Now, one of the things I would like is I actually wanted to think about how I might do a little bit of rendering here without needing a light. I'm all about kind of experimenting with how we think about making some things here in TouchDesigner. And sometimes it's interesting to play without using lights. Right, so in this case, I'm just drawing these things, and they don't have any light that's applied to them. And so that's kind of, right, that's not exactly what I want. Or it's a little too minimalist. Because especially when I back out here, it's going to be black on black, and I can't see anything. So what can I do? Well, I can apply in a material to my geo, right? And materials, which we haven't talked about a whole lot, live here over in this yellow page. And in this case, I'm going to use a constant. Right? Constants emit, constants don't have any shadows. And so because of that, there's no shading that occurs on any of our geometry. And because of that, they're extremely cheap computationally, which is excellent. That's really handy. And they also give us the benefit of creating some interesting opportunities for us. So I'm going to assign that to the material of this geo, right? And here on the render page, I've got an opening for material, and I can drag it right in here in a material or right onto geo, right? And now I've got a geo that is all white. Whew. Bang, bang, boom. Okay. That's pretty interesting so far. We might want to think about maybe turning that color down. Maybe we want to make it orange, right? We could turn down the alpha on this, and we can see that this is treating it all uniformly, which is that's pretty okay. Let's take a closer look at our constant here and see what other options we have, right? Because we might be able to look at our comment page. We could see that we have this parameter called blending transparency. What happens if we turn that on? Oh, that's interesting. Now what we're seeing is that we're kind of seeing every single one of the slices of our geometry, right? I'm seeing all the faces, and they're composited on top of one another in an additive method. So if I come back over here to my constant, and maybe what I want to do is turn down my alpha a little bit more. Right now I've got this really interesting kind of crazy, weird, additive blending situation happening. When I'm all the way at one, I don't have that effect happen at all. But when I'm down here, I do have some interesting things that start to happen. Let's run with this for just 1 second. The next thing that I'm going to want to do is I want to actually draw some lines on top of this. I love me a little bit of kind of like geodesic fanfare. And so let's think about how we might do that. I am going to go ahead and I am going to draw another geo. Right? And actually what I want to do is I want to draw almost exactly this geo to the T, right? I want all of its parameters. So let's think about what that might look like. We could do it this way, right? So I could make another geo. And it's not going to show up, right, because there are no lights. And this geo, I could go inside, and I could delete this, and I could make another box, right? I could kind of think about how do I copy precisely the network that's already been made. And I want to turn on the display and render here, and I would come up here. Okay, that's there. And then I would actually need to come over here to instance. I need to turn instancing on. And then I know that I want to look at instance. And TX, oops, not TX. I want P0. P1, P2, great. And this doesn't have a material assigned to it right now, so it's drawing right over the top and is knocking everything out. Okay, that's not quite what I want yet, right? But I'm getting close. One thing to consider here is that I'm actually drawing these pieces of geometry two different places. So let's say, for example, that for whatever reason, I decide that boxes aren't my thing anymore. What I really want to do is spheres. So I would have to add spheres to one of these, and it changes it over here, but it still hasn't changed it over in this one, right? So now I've got this, I've got to do this thing where I need to go and look here inside of this one, and maybe I want to add a sphere over on this side, and now if I do that and I come back, okay, this is, you know, I kind of lock myself into this game where I'm going back and forth all the time. This brings me to the technique that I like to use when I'm kind of after the exterior and interior, right? The wireframe on the outside and a texture that I'm drawing on top of. And for those kind of situations, I like to use a select, right? Just like we can select chops and we can select tops, we can also select sops. And so what I can do here is I can use this select to actually grab whatever piece of geometry I'm using over here in Geo1. So I can go ahead and create my relative reference here. So now whatever I'm using in this top piece of geometry, I'm automatically populating down here to my second geometry. Okay. Now I still have a problem, right? I'm still locked in this situation where I'm drawing this thing right on top of this other thing, and it doesn't have the material that I want it to have. So what am I to do? So I'm going to go ahead and add another constant. I'm going to go ahead and add this constant as a material. Now I should end up, now I've got it's white on top, and I've got this strange kind of like salmon color that's happening. Not what I want yet. Let's take a look at how we might change this. So in my constant, I'm going to look over here. If I go to the common page, I can see here that there's an attribute called wireframe. So wireframe does just what it says. It draws just the wireframe of it. And I'm going to go ahead and turn my line width up to maybe 2.5 is closer to what I want, 2.5. Okay. Now there is some interesting things that are happening here, right? In terms of rendering, I'm getting something that's kind of cool, but I'm also getting something that is a little bit bananas. Because I'm drawing a bunch of stuff all on top of other stuff, and I'm getting a kind of feedback effect, not really a feedback effect, but I'm getting a drawing situation that I don't totally want. Right? What I am really after is I want to have a sense that I can see these lines only when I'm not actually having my view obstructed by these other boxes. I kind of want to clean this up a little bit. And to do that, what we're going to do is we're going to use a render pass. So render passing allows us to kind of render one thing at a time if we want to. So here in our render, let's go ahead and specify that I only want to render Geo1. Right? So in our render, we can see the star indicates that who our targets are. So I'm rendering all the geometries and all the lights. If I've got a star here, everything please. In this case, I just want to render Geo1. I just want this guy over here. And while I'm at it here, I want to do a few other things. Right? No, actually, I think I'm okay here for the most part. Next, what I want to do is I want to go ahead and I'm going to insert an operator here. I'm going to insert a render pass. Bang, bang, boom. And in my render pass, I'm going to point out that I just want Geo2. Okay. So now, here in my render pass, we can see that what I'm doing is I'm drawing, right, these lines, but I'm only drawing them when I can't actually see through this another part of this box, right? I'm kind of only getting the outlines of these. Now, I could go ahead and I could do a little bit of cleanup here. I could come over to my constant, and I might go ahead and, oh, it looks like my face calling is already set up over here, right? Which is handy. So I can specify that I want to call the back faces because I don't actually need to render the things that I can't see from the position of my camera. I can also see a few other options that I can play with here, right? So I could draw depth only, alpha to coverage, which you can't really see what effect that has here, and a few other options. So this is pretty close to what I'm after here for the most part, I think. Yeah. Now we really get the kind of sense that this is a set of cubes, and we're drawing our lines here on top of this. Now, I like render passing as a method because it allows me to kind of divvy up when I'm rendering or which order I'm rendering things in, right? So we could, for example, if we wanted to, we could draw the lines first, and then we could draw the interiors, and we can see the different kind of effect that has, right? Both of these give us kind of different sorts of effects here. If we were to, here in our constant, for our wireframe, if we were to, in here, if we were to go ahead and do, to cull our back faces, right? Kind of getting rid of, let's, so here we can see, I can see all the things. Let's go ahead and get rid of the back faces. Okay, that creates a different kind of effect here for us, right? Going back and forth so we can kind of see that. We can also turn a depth testing on and off, right? So depth testing off is going to draw all of this, the, what do you call it? Our constant here, our orange geo on top of everything. And our depth test is going to allow us to draw this guy on top. So, you know, some of this requires a little bit of experimentation and a little bit of careful thinking about what is the effect that you're wanting to kind of create ultimately. In my particular example, this is what I'm after, right? I want to draw the kind of exterior lines of our cubes here and let the inside of them be transparent, right? We've got this kind of sense that they are they have a kind of transparent quality to them, and I can't see the lines on them, only on their front faces. Okay, perfect. While we're here, oh no, this is, we're good. I like this so far. So this is jamming. We're getting somewhere here a little bit. If we were to go ahead and turn this on in the background, we could even take a look at our camera, right? And we could play with the position of our camera a little bit more. We could really get a better sense of how this is kind of performing and working, right? Oh yeah, that's fun. As we kind of dig into what's interesting here for us and thinking about how we want this to look ultimately. Now, in this case, I also want to take advantage of the fact that I can replace the colors here inside of I can replace the colors when I'm instancing, right? So we've looked at texture instancing, but what happens if we want to just replace color, right? We should be able to do that. So what I want to do is I would like, for this particular example, I want a kind of random distribution of color across all of these instances. And I'm going to take advantage of the fact that we can move between different kinds of operators to do that. So just like we've already seen over here that we can move from surface operators to dats, I want us to actually move from texture operators to dats. So I'm going to use some noise to actually make this effect happen. So we're going to start with some noise. We need to do a little bit of thinking about what we're after. So if I was to look here at my transform, I can see that I have 64 points. So with 64 points, right, that is, yoink, the number of instances that we're dealing with. So I need to have 64 different colors that I can pull from, right? So I could make an array of that in thinking about how I'm kind of organizing that in GPU space, or I could just make something that was 1 wide by 64 tall. Lovely, right? And that's going to be just about what I'm after anyway. Perfect. All right. Now, while I'm at it, what I would like to do is I need to convert this to a dot. And we can see here that there's not actually a way to go directly to our dots. Well, rats. Now, there are a number of different ways we could do that. Let's look at the chop, a kind of intermediary method first. So we could go ahead and use a top two. So this method is going to actually convert our texture operator to a chop. We can see here that we need to change a few things. So I'm going to go ahead and change my download type to fast, which is next frame. So we're kind of one frame behind in our sampling, which is A-OK by me in this particular example. I'm also going to see that what I want to do is I want to go over here to my crop page. And instead of just cropping to you, right? So you is just across here. What I want to do is I want to have V. I want the column, right? So now I've got this column of information. Now, if I look at this, I still only have 32 samples. So what's going on here? If I take a closer look at this, I can see that I'm starting halfway through and I'm ending at the end. So let's go ahead and extend this all the way back to the beginning. So now I should have 64 samples here. Perfect. Okay. While I'm at it, I'm going to go ahead and next I'm going to convert this to a dot with a chop two. And now I've actually turned all of this into a table. I want to add some headers here. So I'm going to create a table. And in my table, I'm going to go ahead and make it viewer active. I've got R, G, B, and A. We can see over here that I have R, G, B, and A. And in fact, I bet if we come over here, we could include our names. Ha ha ha. And we don't even have to, we can skip this step altogether. Ah, love it. Perfect. Okay. So now I've got R, G, B, and A. And I need to get that here into my instance. So I'm going to go ahead and merge. I'm going to use a merge dot to be able to add another column here into this information. And when I merge, I should see something that is not exactly what I want happen. I should see that it didn't show up over here on the right. And in fact, by merging, I showed up here at the bottom. Not what I wanted. And what's going on here is this has to do in the how method in the merge. And I want to append columns. I want to add these columns to the end. So now I should be able to see that I have R, G, B, and A over here on the right-hand side. Excellent. Last but not least, I'm going to come over here to my geo. And in my instance 2, R, G, B, and A are going to be replaced by the index values of R, G, B, and A. Okay, now we'll see over here that I've got this kind of distribution of brightness. And what's going on is that I went ahead and selected a color here to start with. Let's go ahead and move that back to just white. And what I end up with are just gray values here inside of my noise. That's not totally what I want yet, right? So what gives? Well, part of what's happening is over here in my noise, I'm only using monochrome. So in the noise page, I'm going to switch this off. So now I've got color. I'm going to turn off the viewers here because I don't actually need the viewers for these guys. So what we could think about doing here next is we could use a transform and we could then animate this by moving the Z dimension. So abs time dot, let's do seconds. Now it's going to be a little weird. Okay, cool. So there, now we can see we've got this kind of like rainbow noisy business going on here, right? Yeah, jamming. That's pretty hip. Right? This is one option that we might have for thinking about how we could animate this with some color. We could, think about how we changed our noise, right? The seed of our noise. The harmonics of our noise, we could turn that up and down. The spread of that, the gain, the exponent, right? This kind of dial in some of the other elements inside of the kind of noise effect that we're creating. And what it looks like. to really get some interesting effects that go on. And we could look at that over here, right? And thinking about this kind of streamline, or we could actually look at it when we're dealing with the change inside of our kind of final product here. Okay. So I think there's one other way that we could actually think about grabbing the same information, right? If we didn't want to do this kind of cattywampus trip from channel operator to data operator. So bear with me here while we experiment with a particular idea. Let's go ahead and take a look at the Python information for this particular operator for one hot second, right? Because our texture operators have a particular method that we could take advantage of here. So we can see in this particular example, right? So in methods here, we can see that we can sample something at an X, Y, U, V, or an RGB, A. We can sample something at an X, Y, U, V location to render an RGB, A value. Okay, what, help me understand, Matt. Okay, let's look at just a constant, for example. So we're going to grab a constant, and we're going to give it the dimensions of, let's say, 0, 0, or 1 by 1, right? This is just one pixel in size. Let's go ahead and grab and eval that, because we can use evaluates to kind of test out expressions, right? So here, I should be able to say that what I want to do is I would like the operator that's constant, constant 3, and I would like to sample him, and I need to specify the coordinates for this. X is 0, comma, Y equals 0. Right, and then in addition to that, I would also need to specify what I would like to actually get out of this, right? Do I want red, green, blue? And I would like red, right? There it is. Oh, and we can see here, if I don't specify this, that I get red, green, blue, alpha. And if bet, if I then took this and converted it, I should be able to just spit that into a table here by breaking at spaces. Bang, bang, boom. Okay, so how could we use this to our advantage, right? This is lovely. This is all well and good, but I need a way to kind of understand how I might be able to use this in a meaningful way. Okay, so we could, right, we could use an evaluate dat and a table to get this information. So let's get start with a table here. And we're going to actually populate this table with a series of numbers, right? So we saw already that we want 0 to 64, right? Isn't that what we want? Let's make sure that we got that information correct. Or excuse me, 0 to 63 is what we want to have. We want a total of 64 samples. And in fact, that's the number of pixels that live inside of this guy, or live inside of this guy up here, right? So I want 64 rows inside of this guy. And we could specify this. We could do exact dimensions, and we could say that it's going to be 1 by 64. Oops, I got that backwards. 64 by 1. And that would give us 64 rows, right? Now, I would really like a fast way to be able to take all this and just spit out quickly the number of the row, right? And I can do that, right? I'm going to go ahead and eval. And I need another table. So in this case, the way that this evaluate is going to work is that we're going to kind of plug in here in the top the data, and then we're going to create a kind of formula that we want to use. So here I'm going to say me.input row. This is going to tell this evaluate dat over here that what I want to evaluate for is just the row that I'm in. So this is row 0, row 1, row 2, etc. And in this case, we're going to actually start in our pixel space at 1, 1. And so rather than actually diving in here at 0, I think what I want to do, and I might be wrong about this, we'll see, we can backtrack if I'm wrong, is I want to take me.inputRow and add 1 to it. Okay. So far, so good, right? So if we look up here at this particular formula, we can see that, right? So I'm looking for the operator that's constant 3, and I want to sample x and y. We can then expand on this formula a little bit to kind of dive into that a little bit more. So in this case, I want the operator that's called noise 1, I think. Isn't that what's up here? Noise 1. Okay. We'll see if this works. So I want noise for 1, and I would like to sample that. And I would like to sample that at the x location of 1, comma, the y location, that's my row. Let's see if that worked. Okay, sure enough, we are getting some numbers here. Not bad, so far so good. Let's, while we're at it here, let's go ahead and convert this. And we'll go ahead and split it at spaces. What have we got here? That looks pretty similar so far. All right. We're missing headers, so we're going to add another table. And in this table, we're going to go ahead and give it the exact dimensions of being 4 columns across and 1 row, right? R, G, B, A. We'd merge. In this particular example here, we should be able to just stack these one on top of one another, R, G, B, A. Let's insert a null here. And let's see if this method works. Plug this guy in. Sure shooting, Tex. That worked just fine. Right, so this is another way that we could bypass this kind of method of converting things into a channel operator before converting them into a DAT. Right, now this might be a little bit more cumbersome. We could get rid of all of this noise up here because we don't really need that. And we could kind of consolidate this a little bit. So this particular method is a little bit more kind of like wonky to get there. But it means that we don't use a chop as an intermediary. What's the right way to do it? Well, that's an excellent question. The right way to do it is really going to come down to your particular project and what you're comfortable working with and thinking about. In this particular example, I think that actually the top two chop two method is probably a little more kind of like streamlined because of what we're up to. But this is a handy kind of way of starting to think about how we can get to information, right? Because if we can sample for the RGBA value of any pixel in any array, that gives us a lot of really powerful kind of concise control. So let's go ahead and ditch that for now. And now we've got this kind of like funky looking color cube that's spicy and dandy and looking awfully fun for us, right? And we can, you know, we could do all sorts of things here as well. Right? So one of the things I probably should have done is I probably should have actually attached this to a null and then use the null to go to my top two. Why on earth should I do that? Well, maybe what I want to do is use a ramp. I'm going to set my ramp to have the same dimensions, right? So 1 wide, 64 tall. Oops, 64, not 54. If I use my ramp here instead of my noise, this is going to give me some different kinds of options. Because what I might do here in animating my ramp is I could animate the period, Well, actually what I want to do probably is animate the phase. Right? So in the phase, I'll use abs time dot seconds. So now I've got this is what's going on here in the kind of phase of that. And that creates a very different kind of effect. Whoa. What if instead of vertical, I wanted to go horizontal? Boom, right? This gives me a different kind of feeling. What if instead I want to do radial, right? That's another kind of approach here, or circular even. Right? This gives me almost a lightning, more of a lightning kind of feeling happening. Let's go back to vertical for a second, and let's add a few other keys here to our ramp. And we could start to really dig into how we might really have some fun with this. Right now we've got this kind of progression that's going on here inside of our ramp. And in fact, while we're at it, why don't we just composite? Right, there's no reason we can't composite these two pieces together to give us an entirely different kind of feeling and use that to actually drive what's going on here. Right, so now we've kind of combined some of that animation quality of that ramp, but also the noise here. And we could even think about, if we wanted to, if we move the rotation of our geometry, right, that's going to rotate our internal geometry, which is then going to be instanced. So if we think about rotating this, oh, that's excellent. That's great. This is a great thing to bring up, right? So here I can see that rotating this rotates my color, but not my outline. So how could I fix that? I could over here in my geo, in the Xform page, I could just write some expressions to target my geo up here. So in this case, instead of scale, let's do rotate. And I would like the operator called geo1 and the parameter called par rx. Rx, ry, rz. So now driving something up here in the top should drive both of them. Okay. Abs time dot frame. Oops. And last but not least, I can still, of course, drive my camera around here to really exploit what I'm actually seeing. Right, and there's no reason I can't get closer. And really start to play with this. When we back out here, I can see, lo and behold, that's all rendered over black. And I've got a kind of funky kind of feeling going on here. All right, so that's the kind of experiment that we're going to do in class tomorrow, just to give us a little bit more play in thinking about rendering and the kinds of things that we can play with, especially when we're instancing. All right, can't wait to see what you guys make tomorrow.